Sorry about the little technical difficulties. I had a video thing all set up and then for some reason that died. So we're going phone and we're going old school. Thank you, Coach, for the introduction. I appreciate that. Some of you have heard me speak already if you're a Notre Dame athlete, especially the football team. Today, I'm going to give a little bit of a different talk because this is the first time ever that I'm able to talk about my faith and how that has been challenged, and how I've overcome obstacles in my life, and how my faith is now stronger today than it's ever been. It's my first time being in a private school where I have that luxury, especially at a Catholic school. I'll lead with, I'm not Catholic. I am the son of a preacher man, just like Janis Joplin sang. My children and my wife are Catholic, so I'm raising my family Catholic, and I do attend Catholic church, but I am not a Catholic myself. But I do appreciate Catholic religion, and I love the fact that there's a bishop. And he's revered, and he hangs out with you guys, and he's got a lot of power and authorities. So I think that was cool that he was here today. The reason why I speak, the reason why I go around the schools, the reason why I spend time sharing my life with people is because I believe that connections in communication and life are important. I believe that life is meant to be shared. I believe life is meant to be given to someone else so that they can rise up. I do a lot of talking about leadership. Today is not going to be a leadership talk. There may be a little bit in there, but that's not what today is about. Today is about understanding why we believe in something we can't see, why we live every day with a mighty purpose, and what our why is. Everybody know what I mean when I say what's your why? It's your mighty purpose. Why do you get up every day and what do you do that for? What is the reason why you exist? I didn't always know mine, and that's kind of the story I'm going to tell you about today. I'm 46 years old. Maybe seem old to you, but I feel young at heart. I'm married to the, I outkicked my coverage. My wife is hot. So, married to her for almost 21 years coming up. Her name is Lauren, and we have two beautiful children. My daughter Rebecca is a sophomore at Bloomsburg University, where she swims. She just missed All-American last year as a freshman. And my son Andrew is in ninth grade, and we'll learn more about Andrew in a little bit. Growing up in the town of Pottstown, Pennsylvania, which most of you may or may not know, it's a small town, but it's very urban, very diverse culturally, racially, a lot of crime, a lot of poverty. That's where I grew up. My dad left when I was 9 months old. My mom was a single mom to me and my brother, Andy. Andy was special needs. He today would be considered autistic. Back then, he was considered mentally retarded, which, that doesn't sound pleasant, does it? Today, if somebody calls you retarded, it's not a good word. But back then, it was the only word they had for people like my brother. So growing up in a town like Pottstown, where there was a lot of issues, on top of being poor, living in areas where other people are poor, there's crime, there's bullying, there's issues like that. And we had that growing up. We moved a lot, we lived in a lot of lower-income housing. And my brother was 2.5 years older than me. But mentally, I was the older brother. So growing up with somebody like Andy, who not only did he have the autistic situation he had, but he also stuttered profusely. Who here has ever heard anybody stutter? Close your eyes and imagine the worst stutter you ever heard. Imagine what the person's face looked like when they were stuttering. Imagine how the people around you looked when they were witnessing someone stutter. And then multiply that by a million. And that was my brother. My brother would stutter so bad that his face would contort, his eyes would roll into his head. It was very uncomfortable, not only for him to be stuttering, but to be around him. Because you don't really know how to react to that, especially when you're a kid. So you can imagine he got picked on a lot. What happened back then, and the only way I knew how to handle things was I would punch people in the face when they picked on my brother. That was kind of my go-to. So I got in a lot of fights. I didn't win many of them because most of the kids that were picking on my brother were his age, and those are the ones I was fighting. But I learned how to defend someone. I learned how to stand up for someone. I learned how to be there every day for someone, and that was my brother. That was my job. I felt that was my job, was to constantly be there for my brother. Because he couldn't defend himself, at least not in my mind. Because he wouldn't ever fight back. He would never say anything back. He would never defend himself verbally or physically. So growing up with him was my biggest blessing, but it was also difficult socially for me. People that knew about my brother didn't want to hang out with me because my brother came with me everywhere I went. That was hard. For me, I didn't have any type of issues like that. So for me, I just wanted to have friends and be liked. And sometimes that was difficult. But it was not nearly as difficult as my brother, who never once in my entire life did anybody ever call our house and ask for my brother on the phone. Never. Never once did anybody ever come over to our house and sleep over or come visit my brother. Ever. Imagine that. Imagine your life. What are we, 15, 16, 17 years old? Having never had anyone call you. Never had anyone come to your house for a visit. A birthday party where it was not somebody other than family. Imagine that. July 12, 1989. My brother died in a car accident. It was the worst day of my life. And to this day, it's still the worst day of my life. I graduated from high school in June of 1989, a month before my brother died. I was leaving for the Army in August of 1989. So right in the smack middle of summer, my brother was killed in a car accident. And my world was flipped upside down. I spent my entire life protecting him. Never once did I imagine my life without him. So I woke up that morning not expecting to be an only child. And forever and ever after that, my life will never be as good as it was prior to that day. Sorry. How do you think I reacted to that inside? Anybody?
You were angry?
I was very... Angry is probably not even close to the word, but it's probably the only one I can use here. I was very angry. I was angry at myself because that day I was supposed to pick him up. He didn't do anything wrong. He didn't violate the law, run a stop sign or anything. He had a medical situation that happened, which caused him to go unconscious prior to the accident. There was nothing that could have been done to change that other than him not driving that day, which was supposed to be what I was supposed to do for him that day. I was supposed to pick him up at work because he was having an issue with his car. My dad didn't think that it was safe for him to drive it. They were away at the beach. He was staying with my grandmother. And I didn't want to go pick him up because I had other stuff to do. So on top of being angry, I felt guilty. Extremely guilty. I didn't think that I was deserving of living. I didn't understand why a God who was merciful would allow someone so innocent to die. My brother was innocent. He did nothing wrong. He was perfect. Even if he was autistic, even though he stuttered, his heart was pure. So for me, I wasn't that. I did drugs. I stole stuff. Now, I had a 4.0 grade point average. I was kind of a double agent. But I wasn't perfect. I wasn't Andy. I wasn't who he was. And I couldn't fathom in my mind why. Why would you do this, guy? Why would you take the most important thing in my life? And leave me alone. Unfortunately, the United States Army needed me in August, so I left for basic training. And I proceeded for the next 4 years to do great things in the military. I was highly decorated, did very well with Army intelligence, was in the Persian Gulf War. But I don't remember ever feeling anything during that time. I just did stuff. I did what I was told, I acted, I reacted. I didn't feel anything. Got out of the Army, became a police officer. Joined the SWAT team, met my wife, got married, had my daughter Rebecca. And I realized when I had my daughter, I didn't know how to love her. Like, I knew in my head, I love my daughter. Love her more than anything in the world. My head said that, but my heart didn't feel anything. Nothing. I was always putting myself in positions where I was using physical affection as love. And when you have a newborn baby, the babies scream, they cry. They don't produce any physical affection or love. And it was tough for me. And I remember telling my best friend, am I wrong or am I broken? What's wrong with me? Why can't I feel that? And he says, oh, you're just having that postpartum husband side of that. And that's normal. But in my heart, in my head, I knew that wasn't normal. But I didn't understand why I wasn't feeling that. So for the next 4 years, I stayed as a police officer, and then 9/11 happened. We all know what happened on 9/11. Something inside me turned on. A switch of, it was anger, but it was something turned on. I felt something. And I told my wife I was going to apply for a position with the United States Federal Air Marshal Service, which was recently formed after 9/11 by President Bush. And she said, absolutely not. And I said, well, I need to do this. And I made a promise to my wife many years ago that if she trusted in me, that I would never fail her. And I asked her for her trust to do this. 900,000 people applied for that job, and I was one of several thousand that got hired. I left for New Mexico to go train in the middle of the desert in a remote location with Delta Force and Navy SEALs. It was pretty cool. I'm like, oh my. And my wife was pregnant. And we hadn't found out yet whether we were having a boy or a girl. So while I was in training in New Mexico, she got the test back and found out that we were having a boy. And I don't know why any of this. I honestly have no idea, nor do I care, why things happen the way they happen. But when you look back on things, you have a chance to appreciate it more. And that's what this all is about. That's why I'm talking. This allows me to go in retrospect and think about things and share things and feel things all over again that maybe I didn't feel immediately when it happened. But when I found out I was having a boy, I felt something again. And it felt like love. Because the plan was, I was going to name him after my brother. Again, I don't know why that was important, but it was. I get home about a month before my son was born from New Mexico, and my son gets born in September. His birthday is actually tomorrow. He'll be 15. And when he was born, I looked at him, and I saw my brother. And that feeling was amazing. Up to this point, I had a couple moments of feeling things, but that was kind of when I really first felt something again, something true, something real. We bring my son home. Several months later, we have family over. The guys on the football team, you'll recognize this part of the story. We had family over, just grandparents, aunt and uncle, cousins, and they all brought gifts to give to my wife for the baby. That's usually how that works, right? The husbands don't We don't get gifts. Nobody brings power tools to a baby shower. I'm a baby. So I sit down, my grandmother, who I mentioned earlier, my brother was staying with when he died, because my parents were at the beach. She hands me a box. And in this box is a quote. Based on what I've just told you about me, does any of that sound like I like quotes?
No.
I don't. However, it was a quote. So I immediately go to my grandmother. I think this is for Lauren, my wife. She goes, no, it's for you. Look at it. So I take the quilt out, and it's got yellows and whites and blues and browns and like a teddy bear in the center stitched with Andy. And the first thing I thought of, well, why are they calling my son Andy? Because I told everybody that was reserved for my brother. My son would be called Andrew. I just thought that was weird that they didn't follow instructions. Like in my mind, this was a flawed gift because I told you it's Andrew. But then I looked a little harder, and I started to recognize some of the patterns on the quilt. Turns out, for 13 years, from the date my brother died until the day I got that quilt, my grandmother had held on to all of my brother's clothes that were at her house since he was staying with her. And she put them in safekeeping and didn't understand why she was doing it, but just had a feeling that she needed to keep them. Turns out she did. She made a quilt out of my brother's clothes. So to me, that was an intense, intense moment. I had a tangible piece of my brother in my hands. I didn't have that. When my brother died, there weren't, you know, phones that could record. And we had VCRs that were the size of, you know, a table. You know, nothing was easy to grasp moments. And still cameras and video just wasn't very advanced. So I didn't have anything of my brother that I could really grasp onto. And when I had that quilt in my hand, my life changed. Everybody went home that night, and I went down to my office, and it was about 11 o'clock at night, and I just started typing. I'm a writer. I enjoy writing. My mom's a retired English teacher. It's in the blood. And that night, I cried and typed the whole night. I stand there the entire night. And when I came up from the basement that morning, I'd written 26,000 words of memories about my brother. And those 26,000 memories ended up turning into my book, A Brother's Love, a Memoir, which is a historical record of my life with my brother. And after I got that quilt, it's like everything opened up to me. Like my life became new. I was no longer angry at God for taking my brother. I was no longer angry at myself for not protecting him. I was able to feel love for my wife, my children, for other people. It was like the heavens opened up and lights shined down on things that I didn't notice before. And it was amazing to have that feeling. Has anybody ever been so angry that they just get blinded by everything, they can't see anything around them? You ever had that feeling? It's crazy, right? And then all of a sudden you pop out of it and you're like, why was I doing that? Well, I'm hoping to God that after today, you don't do what I did for 13 years. I went through life, a quarter of my life today almost. Angry and guilty and pissed, and I don't know why I had to do that. Why I couldn't let myself be happy again. Why I couldn't forgive myself for not picking my brother up that day. That's a lot of years to be angry. But what came from it was a renewed passion for my faith, a renewed passion for helping others, a renewed passion for teaching others how to become leaders. I took risks that I would have never otherwise taken because I was able to see things clearly. I was better at my job. I was a better son to my mother I was a better friend to my friends. That all happened after I got that quote. And I don't know why. I don't know why any of these things happen the way they happen. But I learned after this 13-year period of darkness in my life that it's not my responsibility to ask why. That's what faith is, right? Faith is when you believe in something that you can't see, but you know it exists anyways, right? That's what you're doing as Catholic students. I like that term, Catholics. That's a cool term. I'm going to use that on my hashtag that later today. I like that because you have a purpose. Your purpose has Jesus involved in it. It has your faith involved in it. It allows you to get past all the darkness and the anger because you have a bigger belief than just what's happening in your life today. What I found out was my belief in God, while I was the son of a pastor, I didn't appreciate going to church. I had to go to church. I was made to go to church. It was part of my responsibility as the son of a preacher man. My stepdad was a preacher. That's just part of the gig. So I don't know if I actually fully allowed myself to embrace Christ, allowed myself to fully understand the value of having faith. And I think I had to go through this process of darkness and pain and suffering to come out of it with a better appreciation for my faith, a better appreciation for what God can do in my life and has done in my life. And I think that's what we're all here for, right? That's why you are the leaders of your schools, Catholic Athletes for Christ. Because you have something inside you that you need to share so that others follow you, correct? You want to build this up. You want people to join your group. Because we're always stronger in numbers. As a team, that's what sports are. Teams, that's why they have teams. If it was sports were just all individual events, it would be pretty solitary and boring. When you have a bunch of people that are like-minded, have the same purpose, the same desires, and the same goals, and you're all moving in that direction, that's how teams succeed. That's how groups like Catholic Athletes for Christ will succeed, when you get more people onto your team. How many people have ever given their very best, ever once in their life? Your very best. Everything inside of you, mind, body, and spirit, once. Maybe a third of you. Well, in my lifetime, I've done a lot of very impressive physical feats. I've been through Army basic training and intelligence school, jumped out of airplanes, went to train with Delta Force and Navy SEALs. I've been on hundreds of SWAT jobs where I'm kicking in doors and people have guns. I've thought many times in my life that every time I did one of those things that I did my very best. I want to show a quick video here. And some of you may have already seen this video before. It's called the Death Crawl. Why is that a code?
How strong is Westview?
How strong are we?
You're already ready to fight.
We got the
Not bad as a loft, bro.
Technical difficulties. There we go. Alright, cook them with gas now.
Well, not gonna look at beat them.
Just pay attention to the meaning behind this video, not necessarily that it's football or a coach. Just think about the meaning.
What am I rolling out? Not yet. I want to see you do the death crawl again, except I want to see your absolute best.
What, you only got a 30?
Can you get a 50?
A 50? I can get a 50 if nobody's on my back.
And you know Jeremy on your back. But even if you can, I want you to promise me you're going to do your best.
All right.
Your best.
Okay.
You going to give me your best?
I'm going to give you my best.
All right, well, one thing. I want you to do a blindfold.
Why?
Because I want you giving up at a certain point, we need to go further. Get down. Jeremy, get on his back. Get a good tight hold, Jeremy. Alright, let's go, Brock. Keep your knees off the ground, just your hands and feet. There you go. A little bit left. A little bit left. go. It's a good start. A little bit left. A little bit left. There you go, Brock. Good strength. That's it, Brock. That's it.
Better than 20 yet?
Forget the 20. You give me your best. You keep going. That's it. No, don't stop, Brock. You got more in you than that.
Hey, just rest for a second.
You gotta keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's go. Don't quit till you got nothing left. There you go. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving. Your very best. Your very best. Your very best. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. Don't quit on me. Keep going. Keep driving. Keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. That's it. Your very best. Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving. Don't quit till you got nothing left. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. I want everything you got. Come on, keep going.
Hurts.
Don't quit. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go.
It's heavy.
I know it's heavy.
But I have strength.
You can go shake your butt and find more strength, but don't you give up on me, Brock. You keep going. You hear me? You keep going. You're doing good. You keep going. You're not quit on me. You keep going.
It hurts.
I know it hurts. You keep going. You keep going. It's all hard from here. 30 more steps. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Keep going.
Burn.
Hey, let it burn.
It's a burn.
It's all hard. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Come on. Keep going. You promise me your best. Your best. Don't stop. Keep going.
Lord.
It's not too hard. You keep going. Come on, Brock. Give me more. Give me more. Keep going. 20 more steps. 20 more. Keep going, Brock. Give me your best.
I like that last part. Grade 166. What is it about that video? Not the fact it's football or pushing hard or whatever. What is it about that video that resonates with you? Anybody?
He gave it his all.
Gave it his all.
The coach knew that he was like one of he's the most influential player out on the field, and if he doesn't believe that and show that you can do that and generate that to the team, then
absolutely. Why did he put that blindfold on?
So we'll give up when he knew it was hard enough.
Why do we give up? Why wouldn't Brock have gotten to the end zone without the bandana around his eyes?
Because he thought he just had an easy trip to the 20, and obviously he went the whole thing.
Because Coach asked him, he said, how far do you think you can go? And he gave his answer. It was well short of the end zone. Yeah. What happened there? You negotiated, right? You negotiate with yourself constantly. In life, we make deals within our own mind on what is enough. on what is the best, or what do I need to do now to get this done. When you took away the visual, the ability to see where you're going, and you rely solely on faith, and solely on your own ability to push yourself to wherever you need to get to in order to achieve whatever that goal is, that's when you actually truly give your very best. And that's half of what we're here for today. We have faith in something. We believe in something bigger than ourselves. We believe in Jesus. We believe in all those things that they teach us in church. We're athletes. We work hard every day to achieve something. So I'm going to ask again, based on what you just saw and what we just discussed, how many of you have actually ever given your very best once in your life? That's what I thought. I hadn't either until 2008, when I ran across the state of New Jersey to raise money for a charity I had at one time in my brother's name.
It was the greatest experience of my entire life. It was amazing.
I was concerned because he has a bone disease that I was just afraid that he would get himself hurt.
But the workout is here. And I'll be back tomorrow. But they're not going to be. Whether it's for the money or whatever, they're going to need help. And that's what we're trying to do.
Thank you.
Like I said, I thought I had given my very best. When I decided to run across New Jersey, I didn't really think everything through, I'm gonna be completely honest with you. I drove it, seemed okay. 78.8 miles, I'm like, all right, I can do anything once. I believed that my brother was gonna make sure that I made it, that God wouldn't let me fall. And if I didn't have a plan B, I had nothing to fall back on. So I didn't create a plan B. I had to be at that ceremony at 1 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon, and I needed to do it running. Along the way, so I started, I ran three marathons in 3 days is what it came down to. It was over 72 hours. I ran a marathon, ran a marathon, ran a marathon. At mile 40, I had a complete muscle seizure on the side of the road. Right when, on the part where I was talking about giving my body and spirit to something, about 5 minutes after that, I had a full seizure on the side of the road. Got up about 20 minutes later and ran another 10 miles. By the time it was all over, I had 6 broken bones in my feet. I'd lost 10 pounds because I couldn't eat. I was on IV fluids, as you saw in the video, and a doctor traveling with me to make sure I didn't die, because I probably would have if I would have not had that. I'm not a runner. I have a joint disease that's supposed to keep me from running. And I think part of why I did that, on top of raising money for my brother's charities, is I wanted to suffer. I wanted to feel what it was like to live in my brother's world, just for one day. I wanted to know what it was like to have nothing left. No matter how hard I tried, no matter how much I wanted to give it, I had nothing left to give. I wanted to know what my very best felt like. Because now that I could feel again, now that I knew what love was like, now that I knew what opportunities were out there and the greatness of this world that God's created, I wanted to know what I was physically and emotionally and mentally capable of accomplishing. I can promise you I will never run across New Jersey again. That's not happening. But I now know every day what my very best is. I know how hard it is to achieve it. But I know what I need to do to get there. And that's the key. Allow your heart to be open, your mind to be clear, and your vision focused allows you to get there. You're young. I'm not expecting you to get to your very best yet. But I certainly hope that it takes you less time than it took me to get there. My closing words to you are this. I live my life with strength. Whether it's physical strength in my businesses, whether it's the strength of my shoulders when other people need to lean on me, as a police officer in my life at home, or as a public speaker reaching out to kids and young people and other people. I live my life with strength. And as leaders in your communities, leaders in your schools, leaders in the Catholic Athletes for Christ, you are strong. You're strong enough to withstand anything that comes your way. Do not allow yourself to be harbored down with anguish and pain and guilt. I have business cards back here with my email address and phone number. If anybody wants one, you can reach out to me personally. I will help you. I mentor kids on a daily basis. I can give you guidance, even if it's just one phone call. But just know that you're never alone. God is always with you. You are strong enough to handle anything. As long as you stay pure heart, your mind is focused, and you are doing it with a pure intention. Do not allow yourself to get overcome with fear, overcome with guilt, or overcome with pain to such a level that it keeps you from accomplishing those goals. Thank you, and God bless you.